Now, how do I know that there's a difference here? You know, I come out of Babylon, you say this and this and this is Babylon, what's it doing here? Well, you see, an enemy came and sowed these tares.
When when Babylon falls, there's a warning message. When that warning message is rejected, there is a pronouncement, Babylon has fallen, that is followed by a judgment. All right, so when you look at the sequence of events in Revelation 18, you have to be very careful how you explained it to Seventh-day Adventists, because on September 11th, 2001, the mighty angel came down and empowered the message marking the beginning of the testing time for Adventism. And then in verse 2 it says, Babylon has fallen. There is a pronouncement saying that the message has been rejected, right? Isn't that what it means when you see the pronouncement that Babylon has fallen? We had three witnesses to that. We had the Millerite history, we had the fall of Belshazzar, and we had the fall of Babylon. Message rejected, pronouncement, the fall of Babylon, followed by judgment. Therefore, the pronouncement in verse 2 of Revelation 18 that Babylon has fallen has something to do with the fact that the Seventh-day Adventist Church has rejected the message that we're dealing with right here.
He is not only well known to SDA people all around the world, he is also well known to the General Conference leaders of the SDA Church itself. It would be literally impossible for him not to be known by them, seeing how he has been preaching for them at least 49 years. That being the case, not once have we ever heard the General Conference leaders of the SDA Church rebuke this man.
First may LR, God, the undisputed and incontestable Lord of the heavens and the earth, and all that is found between and beyond it, bless you and your family with the best of this world and the hereafter, for your advocacy of reconciliation among mankind and their respective religions. That's nice, isn't it? It's a beautiful prayer. Thank you. Now, you know, Allah is the same God that the Christian worships, I believe. In the Bible that is used by people who speak in those Middle Eastern countries, the word for God is Allah. And so obviously the person who is sending me this letter is a person who follows Islam. Okay, secondly.
And in early writings, page 259, Sister White, and we've read this, I've seen it read by some of the other speakers, talks about a progressive testing process in the time of Christ. Remember, those that rejected the message of John the Baptist could not be benefited by the teachings of Jesus. They went still further and crucified Christ, which prevented them to enter into the holy place. A progressive testing process in the time of Christ. As soon as Sister White finishes that paragraph, she goes into a progressive testing process in the time of the Millerites and says, those that rejected the first angel's message could not be benefited by the second angel's message, neither were they prepared to receive the midnight cry that was to prepare them to enter by faith into the most holy place. Progressive testing process here and in Christ's time is saying that there is a progressive testing process in our time period.
Well, what about this conference president? My goodness, look at him. He's so apostate. Why isn't he on the other side? Why isn't he part of the other rank? Or is he? You know, we have quite a few of those.
But at now, the testing process is underway. So somewhere between Revelation 18 verse 1 and Revelation 18 verse 4, a pronouncement goes out that Babylon has fallen, marking that Adventism has rejected this message. And when they reject this message, in agreement with the history of Christ and the history of the Millerites, what happened in the history of Christ to those people that flunked the test? Early writings 259, Sister White says, but the Jews were left in total darkness. But in the history of the Millerites, those that flunked the test, she says, they were praying to Satan, and Satan answered their prayers.
Neil C. Wilson, past president of the Seventh-day Adventist General Conference, stated in Adventist Review, March 5, 1981, on page 3, that there is another universal and truly Catholic organization, the Seventh-day Adventist Church.
Oh, what about this conference president? My goodness, look at him. He's so apostate. Why isn't he on the other side? Why isn't he part of the other rank? Or is he? You know, we have quite a few of those.
My Bible is plain. Deuteronomy 12, verses 29 to 32 says,
When the Lord thy God shall cut off the nations from before thee, whither thou goest to possess them, and thou succeedest them, and dwellest in their land, take heed to thyself that thou be not snared by following them, after that they be destroyed from before thee, and that thou inquire not after their gods, saying, How did these nations serve their gods? Even so will I do likewise. Thou shalt not do so unto the Lord thy God. For every abomination to the Lord which he hateth have they done unto their gods, for even their sons and their daughters they have burnt in the fire to their gods. What things soever I command you, observe to do it. Thou shalt not add thereto, nor diminish from it.
The difficulty in conveying this truth is that probation closes progressively. And Paul talks about that. We receive strong delusion. Why? Because we would not receive the love of the truth.
So I get into these churches and everything goes. I mean, I've been in churches where the pastor will come onto the stage with an electric guitar around his neck and an earring hanging from one ear and a hairstyle which looks like someone, a guy stuck his finger in the plug, you know what I mean, in the power port.
This whole process took a little longer than we thought it was going to take. And so Dr. Beats is getting his hair done, but he's going to meet you guys in the calf where you can see it. You guys are dismissed.
If you are one that has been trying to share the present truth with Seventh-day Adventists over the last few years, you know all too well how the SDA people
have been taught lately to take Sister White out of context to try and make it appear as if she said never to call the SDA Church Babylon. But is this actually true? And for those of you that don't know what SOP means, it's Spirit of Prophecy. That's why the title says, Please Stop Twisting Spirit of Prophecy, or SOP. As I stated earlier, absolutely every SDA person I speak to admits their church is in apostasy. It can no longer be hidden, and so they have no choice but to admit it. Strangely, after admitting, in the same breath, they declare their church is not to be called Babylon. Do you know what this means? It means they have been taught the exact same church theology of the Roman Catholic people. What I mean is, the Catholics also declare that their leaders are in apostasy, but they don't leave the church. And like the SDA, they too claim to be in the one true church. This also proves the SDA people do not read their Bibles or Spirit of Prophecy. And how do I know this? Well, first of all, the Bible's pretty clear about separating from such as these and not touching the unclean thing in 2 Corinthians 6:17. It's also clear in Amos chapter 3, verse 3, about not walking with someone you disagree with doctrinally. And then 2 Corinthians 6:14 also says we mustn't yoke with those in darkness. And is not apostasy darkness?
And when it comes to the youth, what happened in those places is just unbelievable. The youth hall had a band and a drum set that would have satisfied 5 mega bands today, and they would have been happy with that drum set. But the music wasn't of the quality that you would wish it to be. But the youth was actually jumping on chairs, bashing their posteriors together, swaying their arms. Absolute din. And I'm thinking to myself, excuse me, where am I? Is this a Seventh-day Adventist gathering?
I think your camera is close enough.
And a hairstyle which looks like someone, a guy stuck his finger in the plug, you know what I mean? In the power port.